I just got my hands on this keyboard, or at least what looks like a keyboard. It's actually a character generator from what appears to be the analog era. This would have been used to put titles or names on the screen, probably in a broadcast studio. It was sold to me as a PS2 keyboard, but then I realized what it was. It's kind of gross though, so let's clean it. I just want to take the whole thing apart and clean it the right way. I started with the keycaps, which were pretty easy to remove, then flipped it over and took out the four screws on the bottom. One of those was behind this battery cover, and there were still batteries in the unit. It had an expiration date of March 2003. These batteries usually expire 10 years after when they were made, so these could potentially be from 1993. The brand itself is a little interesting. The only image I could find is this website for a guy who directed, produced, and wrote a commercial for the brand, Fuji Electrocell. It's literally just this one picture. I found some database that said the trademark was abandoned due to failure to respond or late response, so there's very limited information on the internet. Anyway, small tangent, back to the disassembly. I started to try and pry the top and bottom apart, but I wasn't sure if this was the way to go. It was really difficult to get any separation between the halves. But I found a service manual on the Internet Archive, and it shows how to take it apart. It says to remove the four screws and separate the two halves. That was all I needed to know that I was doing it the right way. And that's why service manuals are awesome and should be included for everything. So I went back to it, and after a little more prying, I got the top off. I unscrewed the keyboard and disconnected the ribbon cables, and that exposed the main PCB. I was surprised at how empty it was inside. The board didn't even take up much space and looked pretty simple. We'll take a closer look at that later. I unscrewed the main board, the little secondary board that had a switch and a slider on it, and the RF shield. Also, this other tiny board that was taped to the base for some reason. The keycaps got a nice soak in warm water overnight, then washed with dish soap. All the plastic components got dish soap and a rinse, and I scrubbed it with my brother's toothbrush. Just kidding. It was nice to give this thing the cleaning it deserved. As for the keyboard itself, I needed to separate the gross plastic part from the rest of the components. There was a bunch of screws on the bottom that I took out, then I just started prying. I kept trying to get it off without breaking it, and after a while I realized I messed up the little rubber domes that were under the plastic. They're completely scattered around now. I did get that top plastic off, but yeah, basically none of the blue domes are where they're supposed to be. They're not held in place by anything. But I washed and scrubbed the plastic, which is hard to do one-handed, so I'll put the camera down. Now it's time to get the domes in place. I don't know much about keyboards, but I think they provide the force to push the key back up, and they also help the key press get registered. All I know is these have to sit right on these little beige contact pads. I carefully set each one on their respective pad, and it was very tedious, and it didn't even work. They were still misaligned. But as I was trying to get that faceplate back on there, I realized I can just put them upside down in the holes on the plate. I know, it took me far too long to realize that. But yeah, assembling the keyboard upside down is much better, and I put the screws back in, and I'm done. Now it's time to do a full reassembly. We'll start with the base plastic piece and put the PCB in. It's kind of annoying to get right with all these wires hanging off the board. The battery terminals are also kind of finicky. It's just this tiny spring soldered directly to the board that has to fit in this tiny slot. Then I tried to manage these wires a little so they wouldn't get smashed when I put the keyboard back on. The gray cable is super janky looking, and I realized there's actually a zip tie on it, so. Also, I completely forgot about the RF shield, so I had to disassemble the whole thing and screw that in. I also taped down that small board with the same tape that I had before. Now I can put the keyboard back in and snap the faceplate back on. Now it's time for the most satisfying part, the keycaps. Luckily, I remembered to take a picture of them, so it was easy to put back on. The keys in the middle is just the normal keyboard layout. The keys on the right aren't super unique, but are definitely a little changed around from a normal keyboard. Insert and delete are on the bottom, and page up and stuff is on one column on the right. The top row is where most of the special keys live, including different fonts, sizes, output modes, and date, time stuff. There's a lot of interesting stuff to look into. Some keys require this little metal bar which kind of stabilizes the key. It's just on the bigger ones, so they press down uniformly. The bar has to slide in first, and then it'll click in like a normal one. There were only a few like this, though. The space bar was the one that was completely different. It had the same metal bar, but there was also a spring underneath it to help it pop back up, since it's a heavy key. But, there we go. This is the completed keyboard. I think it looks awesome and much cleaner. All the keys feel like they did before I took it apart. I snapped that little switch back on the right side, but I'm missing the slider part. I thought I lost it, but looking back at the footage, it looks like it was always missing. Now it's time to actually get this thing working. The sticker on the back says it needs 9 volts, so I have my, quote, bench supply ready. To get at the contacts on the PCB, I actually need to take this apart again. Now, the service manual has an entire schematic diagram, which is crucial to getting this thing working. Seriously, every device should have a schematic diagram included in the manual. I don't know what 90% of this means, but it's still really beneficial. The manual has even more in it, down to instructions on how to solder. Good job, Panasonic. On the schematic, it has this little subboard diagram. The input and output switch on the diagram corresponds to the little board on the right side of the keyboard that has the same switch, but there's nothing about that third tiny board on the schematic. It's a little interesting, but let's continue. I poked around and measured continuity at a few different places, and then I realized I could just use the pinout as a starting place. I'm measuring continuity and have my black probe on the ground for the connector. There are a total of 10 pins, and after testing it out, 4 of them are ground. That's what the manual says, and it all seems to be normal. But here's the part that gets me. The connector in this schematic is different than the one my board has. It's clearly 10 pins, but mine is 8. This is for the same model number, so maybe it's like a different revision. I flip through the manual some more, and it turns out this keyboard is an accessory for a video mixer. It's the way you input text into the mixer. Okay, but all the pictures I can find show the video mixers having 10 pins. That's odd. As I read a little more, it looks like this thing might only work with a mixer. I mean, that's the only way it explicitly says it can be used. But look at this pinout again. There's a character out port, which probably goes to the mixer. But there's also R, G, and B out, so I'm hoping I can get a video signal out of this thing. But still, there's supposed to be 10 ports, and I only have 8. As I was poking around inside, I mean, look at this. If this was a super low volume product, it would have been hacked together like this. But there's all this heat shrink and that zip tie. And look at this. The purple wire turns into a red wire. What? Oh, and that mystery board that's not in the manual, and the clearly cut off wires on the connector coming out of the board. This isn't factory, this is custom. I think a studio had this keyboard, needed to make it work for something other than what it was intended for, and someone took it home to their garage and hacked away at it. The cable is not original. This board is from something else. I really hope it was modified to work without a video mixer. That would be the ideal scenario. As I'm writing this, I just had an idea that maybe that mystery board, like, combines the R, G, and B signals into a composite one. I have no idea. I'm writing this part before I get to test out the board. And test I did. I found out which pin needed 9 volts and put 9 volts on it. Instead of using a 9-volt battery, I'm just going to use this universal power supply. It'll have a little more safety and a current limit. I still don't recommend doing this. Just get the right tools like an actual bench power supply. I tried poking around a little bit, but getting at this little connector is a pain. I need a cable so I can break out the connections. After some searching, it turns out 8-pin MIDI is what you need. Luckily, Bang & Olufsen used it for some speaker setup, so it's available online, and I ordered one. I cut the cable up and took off the outer layer and just started stripping the insulator off all 8 wires. This was actually really tedious since my wire strippers are meant for lower gauge wires. Then, I just started checking for continuity. I started with ground by connecting one probe to the outer metal ring on the plug, and then I touched the other probe to each wire inside of that cable until it beeps. When it beeps, that means it's connected, it's continuous. Then I'd move one probe to one pin on the PCB, and then I'd touch each wire and see which one it corresponded to. I took note of each color for each wire and what it did. Gray was ground, brown was plus 9 volts, green went to the white wire on that mystery board, and yellow went to the orange wire on the mystery board, because that makes sense. Now it's time to power it up. I put 9 volts on the appropriate pins, clipped one end of my probe to ground, and then I started poking around with the other one. The yellow wire gave me this signal. It vaguely looks like an analog video signal. Maybe this is the blanking interval, and this being the video, but I think that's a stretch. There were some other weird pulses and stuff, but I wasn't finding anything of use coming out of this cable. I don't know. My setup's already looking like a mess. I've got wires and batteries everywhere. I did forget to mention, the AAA batteries in the keyboard itself are just there to keep power to the memory so you don't lose all your settings or presets or whatever. It doesn't actually affect the function when it's plugged in. Anyway, in the final edit of this video, it's gonna seem like I didn't try very hard finding a signal with my oscilloscope. But I did. I didn't record most of it. I promise I spent a while trying to fix it. I was scrolling through the service manual, trying to find any clues or hints on how to get this thing working. I found a huge table of voltages that actually listed out what the voltage should be for every pin on every IC. So that's something I can test to see if it's working right. The ICs are labeled on the board itself, but there's also a conductor view section that shows a scan of the board that's been labeled with all the traces and ICs. I'm telling you, these service manuals are so helpful, and I think they should be included in the box with everything you buy. The manual even has an exploded view so you can see how all the pieces go together. Exploded view? I'm not kidding. This is the manual uploaded to the Internet Archive. I was able to trace the pin that's supposed to output the red video signal into one tiny IC, then into this big one that actually generates the signal. That little IC is a bunch of little AND gates that have 5 volts and the video signal on the input, and when there's voltage on both inputs, it'll output the video signal, at least from what I understand. I've only taken an intro to electrical engineering class, so take it with a grain of salt, do your own research, etc. Regardless, it is getting 5 volts on the appropriate pins, so that's not a problem. The other pin contains a video signal that gets traced into this massive IC all the way to pins 86, 87, and 88 for red, green, and blue. This is what's supposed to output video. I think the chip generates the video signal. Now there's a simple way to see if it's outputting video. Let's check the voltage chart. It says these three pins are supposed to be at 2.9 volts each, so I'll test that with my multimeter. The two pins before that are at the right voltage, but then the three video pins are at 0.04 volts. That's not good. It's super low and basically nothing. It's definitely not working right. But the pin after that is at the right voltage. So that's a disappointment. I tried multiple times on different days even, and no luck. The last thing I could think of was to check the test points, but those didn't have the right voltages either. I don't think I can replace the IC because it doesn't seem to exist on the internet. I couldn't find anything on it when I looked at the model number. There's still data going in or out. My oscilloscope shows different waves, including this one that's a sine wave that's a little bent out of shape. I also saw what appears to be a digital signal, which was cool. I also tried just probing different pins with it connected to a TV. This little watchman is a very analog device, so I figured it would have the best shot of picking up a signal, but there was nothing. So here's where I need you. I see a lot of comments from people who worked on the stuff I showcase in my videos, or just had a lot of experience with it. Has anyone seen something like this product? Is there any hope of saving it? Or is it even worth it? I'll link the manual in the description. I was thinking of doing the last resort thing of baking it in the oven to reflow the solder, but that's all I can think about, and it would be a pain to do it. I know this character generator is insignificant in the grand scheme of things, but the fact that it's unique and has a little bit more history to it kind of intrigues me. I don't like having a video where I'm unsuccessful in fixing something, but this is over my head. Please let me know any ideas in the comments. So trying to fix it is one option, but if that doesn't work, I have some other ideas. I could make this into a normal USB keyboard. I think it'd be cool, purely for the looks. But there's a lot of empty space in there, so maybe I'll put a Raspberry Pi Zero in it. With 8 pins on the cable, I could have power in, composite video out, and still have 4 extra pins for whatever else. I think that'd be a really cool project. If you have any other ideas, let me know. I'd love to hear them. For now, I'm just going to reassemble it and set it aside. Oh, one more thing I forgot to mention. That weird mystery board has basically nothing on it except for this little IC that, from what I can tell, only amplifies the signal fed into it. I'm not really sure, but it's definitely weird. Huge thank you to my Patreon supporters. Their ongoing support helps me make better videos, and I really appreciate it. If you want to become a supporter, there's a tier starting at $2 a month. It's linked in the description. Thank you for watching.